things start. And I'm very, very honored that Luca Scanzi is here. First of all, because he's my friend.
Yes. And, I'm honored too.
And then because we shared a lot of research together in the last few years, and a lot of topics of research in the last few years. So thank you very much for being here. And just a few words about Luca. Luca is an architectural historian and assistant professor at the University of Rijeka in Croatia, and recently curated two exhibitions on Italian post-war architecture, Atlante dell'architettura italiana degli anni 50-60 and the Italian architect Costantino Dardi. He participated to the 2014 Biennale di Venezia section Mondo Italia with the installation The Remnants of a Miracle, that I think you were talking about. And in 2012 he was visiting scholar at the Canadian Center for the Architecture in Montreal. He was a visiting professor at the Faculty of Architecture in Ljubljana, Belgrade, and the University Ca' Foscari in Venice. So thank you very much for being here, and I hope at the end you have a lot of questions for him. Thank you, Luca.
Thank you, Alberto. Thank you for inviting me. It's a great pleasure to be with you. I will talk today about this installation I made for the Biennale in 2014. And I will try to explain you why I did it and how I did it and which were the reasons why I focused my or maybe I was chosen to do such a work. After my studies, after my PhD studies, I started to work at the university in Venice on a very interesting and ambitious research, which was never really completed, never finished. But the question was, I started to ask myself, together with the professor Marko Pugačnik, we started to work on an inquiry, survey, on Italian magazines from the after the Second World War, so from 1945 to beginning of the 1970s. And we started to, let's say, to create a kind of tabula rasa of historical interpretations about this period, very important period of Italian architecture, but not only in Italian architecture, I would say in general, the culture, architectural culture of the post-war time. So in a kind of way, we started from a kind of bottom-up research. And I started to read all these newspapers and document all the buildings that were published in this an enormous quantity of journals, magazines, starting from, of course, the most famous Domus, Casabella, Architettura Cronaca e Storia, finishing with sometimes very boring, not boring, but less interesting for architects point of view, magazines like Giornale del Genio Civile, or Strutture, or Costruzione Metallica, which is a very interesting magazine, but maybe not very interesting for students. What was the result? The problem is that I accumulated more than 1,200 buildings that were published, and we started to think, what can we do with all this material? So we started to read this building, to study them, and study also the way how the buildings were described and how they were explained to the general public or the public of architects and engineers. So I created a kind of database, which was still quite simple, quite rudimental, I would say, where we put all these things together. And without any kind of historical interpretation, we divided these buildings in some kind of categories, or the way how you could build a database based on yourself in some kind of inquiries. One is architect, engineer, the dates, of course, the place, the name, and so on. But then there are two or three categories which we will work really a lot on them, which are the typology of the structure. You will later understand why we did this kind of inquiries. The constructural figures that occurs in these years. So we try to make a kind of pattern, a kind of net of let's say, a genealogy of thematics that were not strictly connected to architect, to engineer, to famous. Okay, but we decided that every building has the same importance, every building has the same dignity. And let's start to see what will come out of this kind of catalog. So the catalog, when you start to learn that there are some basic information, we simply described not the historical interpretation of this building, but only the way how the structure works, how the building is built, in which material, with which kind of structural figure, typology, and so on. We put some really basic information that were coming from these magazines, so the planimetry, the section, and so on. We also, not all 1,200 buildings, but let's say a big part of this building we also visited with students, by ourselves, and so on. And we documented also their todays, if the buildings were still there. And of course, we documented the place of a kind of small guide, so you can have a reference where these buildings were built. So this started to be, I will not talk, tell you much more about this work, because it changed kind of my further scientific work, because I started to work on many different genealogies that were coming out from the information that the database was given. So let's say I could play all night putting which churches had been built in Italy from 1948 to 1965, or which kind of structures are built with a beam with a V section, or which kind of architectures made in Italy were made of with a three-dimensional simple skeleton. So different genealogy came out, and I started from this kind of work, started to make new histories, new stories, new partial explanation about the Italian post-war context. I don't know why, I don't know how, but probably, I don't know even if because of this work, I was invited in 2014 to participate to the Biennale, organized and curated by Remo Kohlhaas, exactly in the moment when Kohlhaas gave a strong imprint, conceptual imprint on the organization of the general exposition of the Biennale. It was, I don't know if you can remember, if you saw it, but it was a particular Biennale in which the head of the concept of the curator was extremely, extremely strong, and gave birth to, let's say, a kind of not monographic but thematic exhibitions that were held in Venice. The most important was, of course, in Giardini, the Fundamentals. But I was invited to participate to this Arsenale exhibition, which was dedicated to Italy. To Italy, Mondo Italia it was called, and Kohl has invited 38 architects, historians, and curators to participate with very, very, very small pavilions in explaining how Italy absorbed modernity through the 20th century. So, one of the three main thematics of Fundamentals absorbing modernity, the third one was Mondo Italia, sorry. So Mondo Italia had to answer on this general thematic of how this country assimilated, translated, incorporated, I don't know what, the concept of modernity. Of course, when you have this opportunity, it's a great opportunity, it's a moment when you can really show something that to a larger public, not only to academics, to dear friends, what you are doing. So it's a really an issue, a moment. But of course, it is also extremely problematic, because I was working for 2 years in this other project that I showed you on Atlante, and I collected these 1,200 buildings, and I had only 5 meters per 3 meters, so 15 square meters in just the surface to explain it, to tell something about Italy after these years and years of research in new, journals, newspapers, books, and so this was the first problem. The second problem is that they usually, I thought, I mean, you have more time to do some, to make a concept and to develop things. They called me, I received an email Friday afternoon at maybe 3-4 p.m. and I had to produce a concept till Monday morning at 9 a.m. So this kind of thing is quite problematic. So you have only 2 days and a half to produce a concept, to say what you want to do and to reduce all your work in this small surface. So my first reaction was to open all the enormous amount of files and pictures that I made during my trips with the students. This is a picture with our students when we were under the bridge of Musumeci in Potenza, a marvelous architecture. During the field trips I made by myself, I started to look at all this enormous amount of pictures and photographs and documents that I collected, and we all collect during our time. And the first simple, maybe also the most stupid thing that came out from this first selection, from these first ideas, is that I realized that the biggest part of this architecture that I have visited were abandoned, where I use the term remnant. They were simply or neglected, or abandoned, or in really, really bad condition. This the majority, let's say, the majority of this architecture. So this was really maybe. Yeah, a stupid not selection, but the conceptualization of what I had done before. So I decided to focus myself to explain why in which kind of way Italy absorbed its own modernity during the last 40, 50 years through maybe a negative, an opposite message, or a negative message of abandoning its own product or its own modernity. Immediately, the work, I mean, you have to produce a concept, and this concept cannot be longer than 2,500 letters, and so you have to push together all, to condense all the things that are. Circulating in your head, and I started to really put myself during the night writing what can I in which kind of way I can concentrate which buildings I will choose and what I really would like to explain. So a small concept came out. I will briefly just read it together with you. It explains maybe in a simple words what I wanted to explain, and the title was The Remnants of the Miracle. You know that Italy in the 1950s, 1960s had this marvelous period of its economic, social development, and became a country, maybe a seventh, eighth economic, world economic power in just 5 or 6, 7 years from the devastated country after the Second World War, with an agrarian, rural country, became something a very important economic power. So this period of Italian history is called, used to be called, miracolo economico. So an economic miracle that characterized Italian history in the late 50s and the beginning of the 60s. So the title was that I had chosen was The Remnant, so what remains of this period of the miracle. And I wanted to display the month of the abandoned masterpieces of Italian modern architecture during the period that these buildings will be shown both in their current, so wild condition, and in their original appearance. On one side as a dismissed monument, on the other side as products of an ambitious political, industrial and economic investment, and as a result of the most advanced architectural researches of that time. So this was the main dichotomy of this story. On one side, an enormous investment, you will see through these architectures, the amount of the economic and political investment, especially in southern Italy, the investment made with quantity, but also with quality, with extremely good architects, with extremely good engineers that built these buildings. And on the other side, of course, there are today's wide condition. Briefly, I will not go maybe specifically in everything, but when I was writing this, and this is something really sincere at the time, I found myself extremely negative, and I was immediately after when I wrote it out, I had chosen the buildings. I understood that it was an extremely negative and maybe also some kind of pathetic explanation of disastrous explanation of Italian situation. And this is something that I didn't want to. I wanted also to transmit some kind of positive energy of this architecture. Why these architectures have to be shown, have to be studied, why we have to take care of them, what kind of potentials do they have. So about the bad aspect of our history, I have already said a lot. So at the end, there is an aspect which I wanted to underline. This is that every building has its own history of decay. So we cannot generalize too much. Every building has its own history of decadence. But they all describe the different aspects of the failure of the idea of modernity on which Italy has been built. And at the same time, they still show the latent potentiality of the Italian modernity. Still holds. So Italian modernity, in this sense, has a profound potential, which I wanted to show through good pictures of good structures in an old way, like old historians maybe do in a traditional way, showing the extremely good quality of architectural objects that they're not the devastation in itself, not the pathetic vision that I have by myself of how Italy destroyed its own economy, but also with this energy of the architecture of itself. This is something really phenomenological, okay, psychological, which you can communicate only with the strategy of the showing of your of your materials. I will show just briefly some of the buildings that I have shown, just to give you a tip, give you an impression of this methodology of work, and then I will show you also also the way how this was exhibited. Not all the art. Mainly, the architecture I have shown were industrial plants, industrial buildings, industrial offices, so connected with production. But you will see it's not only this kind of typology. This is something that I tried to enlarge as much as possible to show the different how in kind of economy. Constantly destroys or builds different kind of typologies. One of the most interesting, in my maybe most metaphoric buildings of the economic miracle. I hope also Alberto is a great expert of Pierluigi Neri, but I'm sure that he will agree with me. This is an enormous industrial plant in Mantova, which for me is really a metaphor of the Italian economic miracle. this building was built for Cartiere Burgo, an industrial plant that they were doing paper for newspapers. And in one moment, this old factory, which factory that was active still from the 1920s, they grew so much during the 50s and 60s that they needed new spaces. And so they came to, they asked Tunerfi to make a building for them. But there was a small problem, which was connected with a machine that was producing this newspaper paper, which was produced by the owners in a very artisanal way, so from their side. So they assembled the machine, which had an enormous dimension. I think more than 100 meters and long, and something like 12 or 13 meters thick. So they needed an enormous surface to cover this machine, and they came to Nervi and asked him to build a structure that could keep this machine, and on the other side keep it from, because the machine was vibrating so much, so it had to be separated. I think that Alberto knows much better than the story, so that he had to invent a kind of two different structures, so the roof and the surface that had this machine, that they had to be divided. So when you enter into this building, you see still today this enormous distance, about I think 300 meters long architecture, 25 meters large, completely without any vertical element, and that is entirely dedicated to the production. But what is interesting is not only the outside structure, but also the inside structure, which is perfectly studied by Nervi. And of course, why I said that this is a metaphor of the Italian economic miracle, because in the late 70s, I think, till the late 70s, Cartiere Burgo had a kind of monopoly in Italy of producing this product. They had the best machine, they had the best production, they were very competitive in the international level. They asked to Niemeyer to make two buildings and so on and so on. But then in the late 70s came German producer to make a better machine. And they started to lose their competitiveness. No? And slowly, they have lost also their markets, they have lost their economic influence and so on. And in the beginning of, in the last, let's say, years, they closed the building, and the building is now completely abandoned, and we still don't know what will be its future. So it's a kind of parabola that in a central moment of the maximum of the development, economic, engineeristic, but still on a very artisanal, low technology, where Italy was able to produce an incredible production, which produced an incredible architecture, but was not able to regenerate this kind of continuous process of modernization, and lost completely its destiny, lost its sense. As I said, we traveled a lot with the students in southern Italy to document some of the buildings that were built, especially in the beginning of the 60s, in the process of transforming the southern Italy to give work, okay, to southern territories and southern realities. And one of the very interesting processes was held in Campania, in the region where is Naples, where we found, they're not unknown, but I discovered two incredibly interesting architecture. One was made by Marco Zanuso and Eduardo Vittoria, and the other we will see later by Angelo Mangiarotti, designers who were working with designers and architects that were working together with engineers, developing a special kind of prefabricated elements that are were designed for specific purposes and specific let's say context and specific time to answer to different architectural and functional thematics. And this this is one of the very interesting elements of the work in general of the Olivetti factory, which was I hope you know they were doing typing machines and first calculators. They were extremely important starting from the 30s till the middle of the 1960s and so on. And they were asking to architects to develop different kind of architectures, typologies. So all Marco Zanuso worked in different architectures from the industrial plants in Southern America to Italy and so on. But we found in Marcianise, close to Caserta, this enormous complex, where Zanuso and Eduardo Vittoria developed this particular trilithic, simple trilithic system constituted by constituted by a vertical element with a very special section, so it's rectangular that became a lamella and even thinner lamella, which you can see also here, a beam, a V beam, which is reversed V beam, a pre-stressed beam on which you can put some secondary beams to cover all the structure. But what is interesting is this kind of prefabricated element. On one side is extremely interesting from the architectural point. It has a figure which is perfectly studied with very interesting giunti, very interesting connections, okay, studied between all the different elements. And on the other side has a different kind of application. Here you can see this vertical element with the beam and the secondary element. So you can build practically in it is an enormous area in which you can find these different pavilions. You can build offices. You can build even a residential areas. Or this is a relation very interesting between the structure and the space. Within the space is completely empty, so these beams cover more than 25 meters, so you are able to use all the space above in a completely free way. So you have also a very nice relationship between this garden designed by Pietro Porcinai, which is a landscape, very important Italian landscape architect, with the inside. And on the other side you can build a normal industrial plant, which is of course I will not even say any more that it's completely abandoned. So offices, industrial plant, and also courtyards from which you can organize in a different way the passage from the one area to another. Very simple architecture solved with a design of the single element of the, let's say, architect. So with a really interesting tectonic. Another architecture made by Olivetti. This is in this is in Toscana, which is a much older architecture. We are in the beginning of the 50s with Piero Bottoni, an important Italian architect. The time which developed a much simpler structure with this thin vaults in brick, and with let's say very elementary facades, but extremely different and differently articulated vaults in its inside. The second architecture in Marcianise that I wanted to show you is this Stabilimento SIAG by Angelo Maggiarotti, architecture I must confess you, I like very, very much, 1962, 1964. Maggiarotti is a designer, but also an architect. He works very much in connection with the structural architecture. And this is very something characteristic of the Italian culture of that period, which the engineers, architects work with structure as designers. No? Yes, of course, as in solving structural problems, but also transforming structures, so transforming the structural data into the, let's say, technical figures in structural figures, so in figures, architectural figures. And the work of Maggiarotti is also very interesting because even this is an industrial plant that has it's a major industrial plant, so there is a place for producing, but also for this we call servizi sociali and alloggi, so the residences of not the workers but of the administrative part of the society, and some of the servizi sociali, so main sub collective spaces and so on. And it's a prefabricated, entirely prefabricated building with this vertical pilasters which have a section with the letter X, okay, or plus, okay, with a plus on which they put a series of beams and then a roof, and inside the organization of the spaces are completely free, say a kind of open inside open floor. It is very interesting to walk through this building, which is completely covered by vegetation and so on, in which you can breathe some kind of not only structure, but also Miesian space between the vertical element, okay, and the surface of the building, let's say, in itself, and the open space. So how to circulate between one pavilion and the other in symbiosis with vegetation and with an extremely high quality of social of space, okay, for the workers outside the production. So also very interesting places where the light comes in front of the doors. It's a kind of small, it's not so big, but smaller labyrinth where you walk through with this vegetation goes through, and with elements that are separated from the surface of where you work. So structural elements that go directly into the vegetation. This is a picture that is more interesting for the, let's say, the drama of the decay and for architecture in itself. But as I was saying, see this section, very interesting section of the pilasters, because the pilasters are built to be able to receive the beams, no? So the form of this of the structure, prefabricated structure, corresponds perfectly to its tectonic, to its statical sense. As I said, the relation between these elements are totally free, so the structure is there to give the possibility to organize the space in a totally free way, and which of course opens these relations with the green, with the inner space. I find it so simple but extremely, extremely energetic. The second part of the plan is, of course, the product, industrial building, which is built with another system, still trilithic, pilaster, beam, and secondary beams, but with another geometry, with another thickness, with another logic, because of the different sense, because of the different static and functional sense. So we have a vertical beam, which is empty in the inside, or it's made by two vertical elements, with this mensolas here and here that receive, okay, this very thin beam that goes from lamella to, let's kind of kind of V section. And okay, it's interesting, it's a kind of mechanical system that things go very nice together. But then you get inside, and what is really, really interesting is this part, the space, the enormous space, these beams that are, I don't remember even how many meters is this. But what is really interesting is how the place where all the tectonic contact, so the message, you know, the tectonic contact of the something that is really heavy touches the vertical element is completely empty of any visual relation with this heaviness. Okay, so the place where the architecture is light, where it expresses itself through light that comes inside and so on, is the exactly the moment of the of the joint, I don't know how to say joint.
Joint.
No, joint, thank you very much. Of the joint of the two different geometries. So vertical and horizontal. In this sense, yes, of course, you can read this structural element of vertical element, yes, of course, as something that keeps that. But of course, when you see the architectural effect of this structure, you understand that first of all, behind all the structural discourses is a tectonic not even figurative but really spatial effect that an architect wanted to have in a very simple industrial plan. This is another completely different case, a different. I will show you just some typologies. Right? There are 10, maybe 10 buildings in total, where you can just experience the different also typologies of architectural invention. We saw some kind of trilithic systems, which were developed in a completely different way from Zanuso to Mangiarotti, okay, Zanuso with even in the usage of pre-stressed elements. But this is another industrial plate, which is in Piena Santa, this is close to Lucca, Toscana. Marmeria, a place where they were working the marble. And this figure here for you is not known, but this guy here, Sergio Musmici, is an extremely, extremely interesting engineer that worked both with Morandi and Pierluigi Nervi, and that worked a lot with these two architects, Tallini and Montuori, and developed different, very structures together with them. And this is also very interesting, the moment in this part of Italian history, where architects and engineers meet together and work together to a common solution, common problem. And this is a completely different architecture that we saw till now. It's apparently a kind of structural pastiche. But at the end, it's not absolutely true. I'll explain it very short. So it's a see this complicated surface. I see it better. The beamer is not very very good. We call it struttura corrugata, superficie corrugata, so a corrugated structure. It's a kind of very, very thin slice of concrete surface, which is folded. Mm-hmm. Okay, it's shaped, it's corrugated, we call it. And this is just held by these two different systems that are parallel. Okay, these are these vertical cavalletti or that has this I don't know how to say carroponte. It's different. Okay, it's not important. Let's say that these elements, okay, hold this enormous, very very thin surface, okay, of which is just landed on these vertical elements. The geometry of this surface is just studied through studies in with some in the laboratories of
construction and so on, to respond and to be completely in equilibrium with this vector system. So it's Musmeci was very famous because he was all the time using as less concrete as possible. So we were in the years, in times where the material costed much more than the work of the workers of the building companies. So it was very important to use as less concrete as possible. So he started the perfect, let's say, for him, the perfect kind of structure that had the possibility in the asymmetrical. See, this is an asymmetrical structure. This is a facade. This is the inside pilaster, and this was the place for the trucks and so on. And this was the place for the working of this marble. So it's heavy pieces of marble. They had to be transported. They had to be worked out and so on. And this structure, well, is completely free, okay, and outstanding in over. Over the other. So this is a carapone. This is what I don't know how to say it in English. But this is the so the, this beam here is has been used for this carapone to bring things from one part to another. This is another very interesting and funny architecture. Is the hippodrome, and this is not so connected with the let's say Italian economy. But in the last couple of years in Italy, they stopped to organize the horse competitions and bets and so on on a big scale. So this hippodrome, which was built during the in the period of the Roman preparation for the Roman Olympic Games, which was in 1960 in Rome, of course, this competition won by La Fuente, Virago, and the engineer Becchini was so they went over, but the building was closed, I think, six or seven years ago, and it's very interesting because it's not really a random. Everything is there as 5 or 6 years ago, when people were still going there and making bets, and there are still machines there, and pieces of paper where you sign the course that you want to bet on, and so on. So the building is in fact in a very good condition, but it's very interesting also to document the end also of this other part of works that have been done for the Olympic Games. And the structure is not so interesting, and maybe in the structure way as an architectural Nervi or Morandi or even Musmeci, but it is interesting in my opinion because of the inventiveness, and also it shows how architects were thinking in this period, primarily through the communication, so the relation between structure and form. Okay? So even the usage of color, even the organization of the space, it was all thought within this enormous expression, even over expression of the structural when you can admire this kind of very simple structure which has a kind of hexagonal or triangular grid with this kind of doubleness of these beams that give the possibility to this enormous roof to go over the tribunes to the border, okay, of the pista where all these horses run. So it was also very funny to go around to see the building, how it works on the roof, and see so the relationship between these structural elements which are painted so on, and see this enormous space that is held on this very complex structure that goes from the basement to the roof. Just a couple of pictures just to feel kind of the taste, I would really say the taste for structure that was characteristic for these years. Of course, this was painted later, but then, of course, I will not talk about great, great monuments of the Italian economy, where our Alberto is knows perfectly well. It's just a couple of pictures of just you have been. I don't know. They have been. Have you ever been? No, you didn't took them to see.
No, no, it's not possible. Absolutely.
Okay, just to feel the incredible richness, formal richness of the space, which is the Palazzo Auditorino, which of course is empty, but still communicates this incredible structural informal energy. From the point of view also about the photography. The photos, I must say this, the photos were all made by myself, by Marco Pogacci, by a couple of very good students that we had. We had no professional photographers. We also, this is not an excuse, but it's also a kind of... I wanted to show a kind of rudimental work also from the point of view of the research. Okay, we were very focused on doing many photographies and photos that we wanted to have, but without very good machines, without very good equipment. Okay, so the sense of the work had to be not to dramatize, to emphasize, but to show as our eye sees this structure. Another very important building here in Torino, Salone dell'Automobile. Another, I thought that Alberto showed you this building, but it's really particular building. That today I don't know if it's open now, because when I was there, it was a circus, and there was a parking place and so, but it was completely empty. It's a in a gigantic pre-stressed structure, which is really, really complicated. I will not insist very much. And then there are some buildings that don't exist anymore. And for me, I don't know, maybe people know about them, but I never heard about them. Are buildings that were destroyed maybe already in the late 60s or something like that, because it was simply built as a small pavilions and experiments, which shows how part of I don't know even who is Giulio Lenzi Orlandi, but how this there was a kind of correspondence or admiration towards Torroja and the Mexican school. It is also a continuous pre-stressed structure built by segments, okay, that were constantly pre-stressed, tac tac tac, till this part here, which is extremely thin, which is also corrugated, which we don't. I was here, I couldn't find any trace of building, but a building that it is worth to research, no? To understand what I stopped myself with the field trip and with this documenting of the structure in the Architettura Cronaca Storia, a very small article, maybe half a page, that documented this building. I didn't find in any other place any reference to this building, but it's interesting to note that there are a lot of things that we still don't know. Then there are other buildings which are much, I mean, they are known, but that are really, really simple in their architectural development, but very interesting in their spatial results. So this is the Mercato di Fiori. It's a roof. It's a simple roof of a great vault. See, this is a vault. This is a place for the story arts and magazines and so on. So a place where they were selling flowers. Pescia, it's close to still in Tuscany. With this very, not very important, but quite important engineer, Giuseppe Denzogori, that worked with Savioli and Andonici. And it's a big structure that was built with some patents that were at the time quite actual, and this is a kind of, it's a brick structure. Okay, so this you see this enormous vault, quite thin, and when you see it, you see that it's kind of looks like a monolithic concrete vault, but in fact it's a system developed quite commonly in this period. It's called Terra Grave, which was of a reinforced brick, which was made on the ground and then was brought to the level of this so it's a kind of really thin structure that covers more than 8 to 20 meters of structure. So you see, we have a lot of different typologies, a lot of different building techniques, building systems, structural features. And then there are also some other architectures which are absolutely interesting, which are connected more to the architectures made for office buildings and office building during the economic era. This is a very simple example of the very first, one of the first Italian curtain walls realized in the late 1960s by Melchiorre Vega, which is quite a good architect, but Arturo Dall'Usso, a very good engineer. Where you have all the surface completely freestanding from the, and it's extremely elegant. This building now is closed, very complicated story, and so on. And also many schools, many architectures that are connected with the process of education of the children. Without parents, of course, and so on, that closed, I don't know exactly where, in the 80s, and the buildings that are designed by Silvano Zorzi, very good engineer, Vittoriano Milano, an important architect of the Milan school of the post-war context, which was built in a very, very interesting relation with space, with the landscape, in this idea of color, this idea of how architecture had to give warmness to kids in a process of education and building the personality of these kids. I will show you the last couple of buildings, which I really, really like, and which are also connected with the Colonia, where the places where during the summer, the workers could send their kids for summer vacations, and the colonies are mostly connected to the big state or private factories in Italy at that time. These two are formed by Eni, AGI. That were built once by Giancarlo De Carlo, second one by Edoardo Bella, and it's incredible architectures that are very, very interesting from the point of view of the spatial organization, right? That of course are today completely abandoned. This is a Riccione, it is close to Rimini, just on the beach. This is not the original plan of Riccione, but I couldn't find it this morning when I was doing the mapping. But it's very similar plan of pavilions developing in this open form. So just a kind of similar plan, just partially designed by De Carlo. De Carlo was a member of Team 10. De Carlo was a very interesting architect, really from the point of view of developing very interesting planimetries. And very interesting working sections where the spaces for children were designed in the kind of articulation not only in plan, planimetry, but also in section, with colors, with the focus on the views and the relationship with the beach. So it's very, very interesting. Today, you see these pavilions organized with this marvelous landscape in front of you. In a devastated situation, they are waiting for really collapse, so they have the excuse to remove it and build a new hotel and something like that. Of course, it is absolutely impossible to reuse it. But see, so this is the entrance and how this dormitory is open to the landscape, with this open structure, surface that changes also to these standardized spaces in an architectural manner. The bathrooms. This is the second building. I will show you a video later of this building, and you will see the condition of this. This is an Alpine colonia. It's a colonia in the Alps, close to Borca di Valore, is close to Belluno, somewhere. And the structures are made by Sivan Zorzi, and a very, very interesting architect, very close to Carlo Scarpa, so Eduardo Gheddè, that you will see later, an enormous complex of it. So, just to conclude, this is the image of the Arsenale, main corridor, and we had to put all these materials between this column and this column, from the height of, I don't remember, 70-75 centimeters till 4 meters and 30, and we had to leave a passage here. And all this that I told you had to be kind of way organized there with only 4,000 euros. It's important to know the economic part of all this operation when you go to an exhibition and you receive no money, okay, to participate in a great, great, great opportunity to participate on Venice Biennale. I started to work with a friend of mine, who is Marcello Fodale, an architect from Venice, who has the same taste as I do, and we started to work on elaborating bookshelves made by Albini in the same year. So it's a kind of stressed shelves that are in kind of way that are stained, that are in balance. Just when you tie the wires, and we started to imagine a very, very, very simple structure, maybe in aluminium, light aluminium, which could be stressed, and we put the lights inside, simple nails, the cost of 12 euros each. Inside to distribute light, because the first goal, as I told you, was to give this formal power of the structure to the bathroom. So I was not interested in communicate all this that I have told you today. No? I was only interested, because Biennale is like that, you have 10 seconds of time of the observer to catch him. Okay, you have 10 seconds to give him the basic information, in my opinion. Because Biennale is an enormous chaos, it's an enormous fair, and people don't have enough energy and concentration to capture all the things that they were, and especially in this Biennale organized by Cojas, where there was an enormous amount of people exhibiting. So my idea was to give to the public the pictures of this structure, so they could start there and just say, okay, I will read it, I will try to understand what this guy wants to tell me, or if they are not interested in this kind of thematic, they just can go away, but they can remember the power of, say, the image of some of the art. So I decided to use a textile which was expressed very well the photos with the retro illumination. Mm-hmm. So the reason why we put the lights inside is to give this textile the energy from the behind, so these pictures could really communicate not only through the image itself, but also with the light. So we put different things. I will not go. Tell you how they were organized, details in the top, and the things and so on. You know more or less all these things. And it looked like a kind of illuminated bookshelf in the middle of this enormous, enormous space. And this is 9 meters, okay? This is 80 meters and 30. And this is, I don't remember, but I think 2 meters and half. So we had also, you have to imagine a big thing that you have to do. You have to make a kind of architectural presence in this space. Where we also showed some videos here, which I will show lately, and with a series of this picture. And a small message, which was, sorry, the idea was that you look through the main arch to see the biggest. I prefer this element, this architecture with the remnants of the miracle. So you go back, read, see the movies, and go on without any other. So the structure is in fact is extremely simple. It's a kind of shell that can be also a lamp with this as an element of tying together everything. And this is also was a kind of spirit of it. We didn't have money to make holes, we didn't have money to make complex. So we have chosen a simple element taken from the building site on which we could, and it showed also the cost of this operation and of all this system. And the fact is that the reaction was quite positive. It was quite positive, especially because this. This was one of the rarest pavilions in this part of the Biennale, this, let's say, Arsenale, which was talking about architecture. And this is not so elementary, this is not so common. Maybe the conceptual part was hidden or was in the second part, but architecture as an element of. Expression as an element of transmitting a message was, I think, quite great. I would like just to conclude showing you a couple of videos that were made by our students, especially by Federico Padovani, later photographer and also videomaker that worked with us, and he graduated with us, and so on, started a career in this sense. That when we produced very short videos, 2 meters maximum, 2 minutes maximum. This is also ultra maximum. Well, how a general visitor of an exhibition can concentrate himself on a video. And we mixed, they mixed also some kind of nice music, and we produced this thing. So with the idea of not only have static images, but also to get you inside the buildings and to reflect on these two thematics. So yes, the abandoned, neglected buildings, but also the quality of this structure. I will begin with Colonia Eni Gellner and Silvano Forzi, and you will see this colony with these long corridors spaces dedicated to kids, the main star, refettorio, the dormitory, which you can feel the relationship with between the building, the architecture, and the idea of how it was used in past. Thank you.
Cassin, Cartiere Borgo by Cartier Luigi Nervi.
Thank you.
grazie.
Thank you very much, Luca. You show us very interesting structures, and when you talked, I was thinking at one of the structures that you are studying in these days at the Molinos factory here in Castiglione, and I think that some images are very, very similar to the internal of this very huge building. I don't know if you have some questions to Luca. I hope yes. Curiosity about this period.
Please.
I thought. He's a very impressive title of Remaining to be Record, and yet probably part of the beauty of the picture you show is due to the fact that the buildings are abandoned, and I wanted to know your opinion about that position, like should that stay like a memorial of this miracle, or do they have to be used again and in which way?
Ah, thank you very much. Let's say that the exhibition, or not the exhibition, but this installation had the purpose to document state of decay, and especially the state, not only the state of decay, but also our inability to reinvent those places from the point of view of the administration, economy, city, till also our discipline, architecture. So not, in Italy, at the moment I know maybe 5, 6, 7 buildings that were of this period that were restored and rethought. It's not a question only about the architect, but also how to use and which kind of, what can we do here? We have an enormous quantity of problems. Technological, isolations, bureaucratic problems, but we also have conceptual problems. What are we going to put here inside it so these places can have a future, any kind of future? We cannot do contemporary art museums everywhere, because it's of course inside nearly to see the beautiful work of Walter de Maria or Richard Locke would be really great, but you cannot do it in Marcianise. You cannot do, we cannot transform this only in exposition of itself, okay? So we have to reinvent. And this is something that in some kind of way we have to, as you are doing here, start to work on. The people, some of the architects started to do that, but I think the question of the renovation is completely different from the concept of the renovation of the building from the 15th century, 18th century, 19th century, even Le Corbusier building. It's another kind of restoration, which is more in inventing the sense and the future of the building than the building itself. We cannot conserve them and restore as they were. I mean, we cannot do it. We can do it maybe with one really great masterpiece, but no, we cannot do it with all of it. I mean, it's not, we need an impossible quantity of money. Today I read an article, sorry about this, the Italian state gave in the 2015 95 million of euros for research. The same amount of money as Juventus bought a player 3 days ago. So we have to be very clear and very honest and say, come on, we don't have money to restore this place. We have to invent how we can from what we call function of sense, reinvent these places to bring possible investments. We cannot ask to the state to do that. It's not responsible. So we could completely to change our mentality in front of these buildings. I mean, it's not Michelangelo that, okay, Michelangelo has to be a certain artist. This is something completely different. And we have an enormous amount of buildings like that, that in every, I'm going to say, every city in Italy, but many cities in Italy have, and it's an open question. I don't have an answer. I didn't have an answer. Did I answer to your question?
Yeah, okay. I wish to recognize with this consideration, saying that one of the most important architects of last century was Giovanni Michelucci, who was in the board of the jury to that promote the NERVIS project for the Palazzo del Lavoro. He was worried at the moment of the jury because he said, we never don't know what to do with this building, even if we plan to do a museum of dinosaurs inside. But I also have a question for you, but I don't know if it's a question or just a consideration or a provocation. Because each day there are a billion of persons who pay to see ruins and pay to see spaces that are generated by voids. So a billion of people pays for seeing voids. For example, the ruins in Knosso, in Creta, in Athens. Do you think that, but I think you haven't got the answer, but from now to 10, from 100 years, we will be able to pay to see the void, for example, the Palazzo del Lavoro, or is better to destroy the Palazzo del Lavoro, because we can manage this space now? In my opinion, in certain cases, is better on destroying this space.
Yeah, I know what you mean. But I am not ready for that.
No.
Now I will give you a very completely different example of. It has not a nice parallel, but for me a strong parallel. Okay. I come from ex-Yugoslavia, so when I go to Sarajevo, I go and I see a city that is destroying all the remnants of the war. So I understand perfectly that people need to have their life, normality back, but a monument, this kind of monument, a building, which is a kind of skyscraper in the middle, of the city. Now there is a discussion of what to do. So to leave it as a skeleton, or the remnants of this bombing of all the time, or to destroy the refurbishment. I think that sometimes memory, a ruin that can remember us about the incredible stupidity of humanity has to be. Stay there, even if it's ugly, even if it's they have to give a kind of provocation to the population. And when we destroy things, we erase them. And maybe sometimes it is good to preserve some of these buildings in order to also document, I don't know, maybe the Italian economic miracle, but what Italy and what was the energy of Italy in a specific time of its history, its economy, and today it's not anymore. We cannot, absolutely not understand this building. This is from our point of view today, I don't know if you agree, it's unbelievable that it was possible in Italy.
Mm-hmm. If you see Italy Builds, for example, we are both a fan of Kindersmith and
yes,
the wonderful
yes.
book that I hope you read that is Italy Builds and demonstrates the things that you are going to say.
And maybe it doesn't have. I wrote this speaking, we also talk about the fact that modern architecture has a dignity even as a remnant. In the sense that maybe one day, maybe we will not find the same amount of people that will go to see Uvarra and Neri, but maybe from the architectural point of view, spatial point of view, they both are so strong that they deserve to be things just to see. Nobody goes in the tourists don't go to see Uvarra, to use Uvarra, to see, in the same way also there. Of course you cannot do it that in Marcianise, because nobody will go to Marcianise in southern Italy to look at these things by Mangialotti. This is really something that we like and go and appreciate, but we cannot share this with people, no? And this, of course, just document it and okay, you erase it, but it's a pity, no?
Have you got other questions? Okay. If you haven't, thank you very much again.
Thank you. Thank you very much.